Good afternoon. It's 4 o'clock here in Denmark. And my name is Pal Andersen, and I will be giving you this webinar. I expect to be 1 hour or something with talking about this topic here, structural health monitoring using ARTeMIS Modal. So I have divided this little webinar here into five sections here. I'd like to give you a little introduction first to ARTeMIS and the different plugins we have for health monitoring. Then I'd like to talk a little bit more detail about the methods that we use for operational mode analysis when it comes to monitoring a structure over time. And continue with some other techniques we have developed over the years that concerns damage detection. Also of a structure over time. Then I will give a case study and finally some conclusions. And in between, I will try to switch to the software, to ARTeMIS Modal, and then demonstrate these different aspects that I'll be talking about. You're very welcome to write questions to the chat function we have at WebEx here. And you can also write emails to us if you want afterwards. There is an email address here that you can use, and then we will respond as soon as possible after the webinar. So this is the plan, and let's see the next slide here. You know, health monitoring is many things. It consists of many aspects and many techniques and so on. But what we are concerned about when it comes to ARTeMIS and the software, that's the vibration-based part of it. So what we are doing is we are collecting measurements, we are analyzing them, and we are delivering results based on this. This is what we have developed, you could say, our software suite around. And we have then developed in a way so that it can plug into a larger system where you have a data acquisition system that delivers data. And you may have a database system that will then absorb the results when they have been produced. So you imagine that ARTeMIS is kind of the place where you can then process the raw measurements and get results out. One thing that is, you could say, important to get the best out of this, that is that you have to place your sensors on the structure and keep these sensors running on the same locations and directions, you could say, for the whole lifetime. It may be difficult, but you should try aim for this, because this is the way that you get best results out of analyzing it with ARTeMIS. Another thing that we actually require is that you more or less measure the same amount of you could say, samples every time. So let's say every day you measure for 1 hour, and we analyze this with ARTeMIS. It's not a good idea that you analyze 1 hour one day and the next day is only 10 seconds of data. Then you get inconsistencies in your results. So make sure that you have the same amount of data. And if you set up a data acquisition system to run every day, it is most likely also the easiest to do. So in ARTeMIS, there are a set of modules that are designed so that you can plug this in to a larger system. What we have done is we have developed a module that can automatically read files from some network folder. So we can read the data files into ARTeMIS, and then it can actually do the analysis automatically. And in a similar manner, we can then provide the results either to a file at some location or to a database, depending on the needs. So we have these different modules that allow all of this, besides, of course, doing the actual analysis. What we have done is we have extended for some years ago ARTeMIS, because in the beginning ARTeMIS was just a mode analysis software where you read in, say, a measurement file, and you analyze it, get modes out. And then that's it. That's a project that you have developed then. What we had to do was we had to extend the way we think about a project so that we can actually measure over and over and over again in the same project. So what we did was we developed what we call an analysis session. So that means every time you measure, you make a new measurement and you upload into an ARTeMIS project that are running for health monitoring, then the data is stored along with any results that are produced for that data. And in this way, you have a project that doesn't only consist of a project file now, that is the normal AMP file that you see here, but you now also have a set of files, as many files as you have uploaded data and analyzed it. And these are the so-called analysis session files, and they are then having this extension here when you see it in a file folder. So there is one of these files per measurement that you upload. So in this way, we have extended the way that ARTeMIS works, and we use several files, not to have a huge project file in the end, but having something that can dynamically can grow in size without we have to overflow the computer. You can see these analysis session files located anywhere on your network. And basically, each of these analysis session files here is actually a project in its own. It has all the results and everything that is related to that specific measurement that has been uploaded. When you start up the ARTeMIS project the first time, you start by initializing the things that you need to get, like geometry, and you need also some initial data. And you need to inform ARTeMIS where on this geometry the different channels are located. And all of this is stored in a master session or a master analysis session. That's the initial session that you create. Also stored in this is all the configuration that you need to set up for signal processing, for mode analysis, and so on. All of that is also saved in this master session. And then the idea is that every time you now load some new data, we will look at how the master session has been set up, and then we will process the new uploaded data in exactly the same manner. So we'll do exactly the same kind of mode analysis every time we upload new data. That's why we have to have some kind of template for all of this, and this is what is stored in this master session here. I would like to show you now a little example in ARTeMIS where we set this up. This is based on some data that we have obtained from some colleagues in Italy that has been measuring multiple measurements on this bridge here. This is the Dogna Bridge located, or it was located, in the northern Italy. Now it has been replaced by another one because there was a significant flooding happening in 2003, as you can see from these pictures here. And this caused this bridge to be damaged so much that they decided to replace the bridge. But before this happened, these researchers, they were allowed to do artificial damaging of this section here of the bridge. And then while they were doing that, allowed to, of course, do measurements also, so they could use them for damage detection. So here you can see how this section here has been instrumented. And here you can see some of the damage that was introduced during this campaign here. We have some of the data, we don't have it all, but we have some that allows us to demonstrate the use of ARTeMIS. What we need or what we have here in this example here is we have a configuration file. This is one way of, you could say, initializing a project from an ASCII file. Then we have eight files that have been measured in a reference, you could say, state. So that's before they start doing all this kind of damaging here. They measured for a while, and we have eight files of same length from this period of time. And then they started doing all kinds of damaging and measured at the same time. And here we have 14 damage cases, 14 files that we also can have a look at. Each of the files consists of the same 10 channels. that has been located the same position every time. For those of you that are familiar with ARTeMIS, you also know that the normal ARTeMIS, if you do an operation model analysis with ARTeMIS, you are allowed to use multiple setups. So you can move around with your sensors all over the structure and use some reference sensors to link these different setups together. This is unfortunately not the case when it comes to health monitoring. Here we restrict ourselves to having a single setup. So that means that you have permanent installation, or this is what we assume at least, that you have a permanent installation on your structure and you are not moving around with the sensors. So we have made this restriction here that it's a single setup analysis we do every time we upload new data. Let's see here, before we continue with this, I like to go to the software here now. We have it here and I would like to upload a file. I have the file line here. This is a CFG file. This is the extension. This is a configuration file. And as you can see, it's just an ASCII file, consists of different information that is needed. There is a keyword, in this case, header. And along with a keyword, there is some information below. So the information below the header is simply the title of this project here. Another keyword is capital T here. This is the sampling interval. And below there, you specify the sampling interval in seconds. Then there is a section here where you specify the geometry nodes. So that's the nodes that you can link with lines and with surfaces and so on. Each of these nodes is characterized with a number, a unique number here, and then with an X, Y, and Z coordinate here. And you can then specify as many of these nodes as you need in order to describe your structure. And this is of course needed if you want to see mode safe animation and so on, that you do this with a reasonable accuracy. Below here, you can see this is trace lines. The keyword is lines here. And below this keyword here, you specify a trace line. And the first trace line is between 1 and 2, in this case here, node 1 and node 2. And then you have a lot of other definitions here down here, as you can see. So this, in this way, you can make a wireframe geometry to animate. You can always also add surfaces that are triangular, solid-looking objects. We don't have that in this configuration file here. This is the original one that we got years ago. The next thing we will do is we will have to link or tell where the different measurement channels are located on the structure. And to do this, we need the first of a series of reference measurements. You can see here that there is a keyword called setups here. Below this, we know that here we have to read the information about where the data is located, what file it comes from, and also what locations the different channels are located in. So the first we have of information below this keyword here is simply a label. So this will be the label of this setup here when we load it into ARTeMIS. The next line here, this is actually the file name. So the data is located in this binary file here for the first session, the master session. And then below here, we specify then, this is for the first channel of the file. We have these four numbers here. The first one here is the nodes it's located in. And the three remaining numbers here is the X, Y, and Z. You could say directional vector that indicates here that we are pointing in the vertical Z direction. This is the one that is one here. The other ones are zero. And you can see all the channels, they are actually pointing in the vertical direction in this case here. There are 10 channels, as you can see, and this will be the same for all the measurements. If we go to, let's see, the file explorer here, where everything is located, you can actually here see the file that I have opened here. This is this configuration file here. And below here, you can then see the 8 reference measurements. There are 8 files here. We will be uploading the first one here when we open this configuration file. later on we have to upload the rest of these reference measurements here, and we have to do this in a kind of a manual way because we have to set up the whole mole analysis. The automatic mole analysis has to be configured, and basically also the same with the damage detection. So we have to start up a little manual doing this, uploading some reference measurements and get started. And once that is done, then we can set everything to run automatically and process the data. Up here, you can see the remaining files. These are the damage files, different ones. There are 14 of these, as you can see. So let's start. Let's upload this data here. We go here to ARTeMIS. I right click here on create new project, and then I specify I would like to make an OMA project, operational mole analysis project. It is only output only or response measurements I have available here. So I like to use an OMA template, and I like to use what we call external storage. This is where we are now storing these session files in some specific location, and they are stored separately. So I simply select this one here, this option here. And now I have to tell where do I want to place these session files. And I can try to see I have a folder here that I can specify here. This will be the place that I will have these ultimately going. I select it. The next thing I have to do is I have to specify this configuration file. So I do that by going back here. You can see it's lying here. And then I simply double click on this one here. So now we have actually a project initialized in ARTeMIS. You can see that here there is an indicator that tells us that this is actually the master session we are now having here. And it's called this reference underscore one here. So what we can do now is we can configure how to process this session here and how all the other sessions later on will be processed. So we can go down the different options here. The first thing I like to do is I like to decimate the data. It has been acquired with a sampling frequency of 400 Hertz, which gives us then an analysis range up to 200 Hertz. But in this case here, there is no modes above 50 Hertz. So I like to decimate the data. There's no point in having data where there's nothing in. So we go here to 50 Hertz instead. And then the next thing I like to do is simply to go down here to the bottom where I have my model analysis tool, the stochastic subspace identification methods. This is some of the tools we have available, but it's the preferred tools for this kind of analysis here. And here I like to specify which of all these I like to use. And by default, it's just two, but let's restrict ourselves to one. Then the last thing I have to do is I have to tell that I like to do this in an automatic manner. So that means when I have data coming in, automatically modes will pop out in the end. That's it. Now I can run this analysis for this first master session here to have a look at the data, the results, fine-tune the settings if necessary, all of that. And in the end, you can see here that a series of results has been produced here. There's a list of them here. But we can go here to the so-called analysis history, which allows us to track what's going on, you could say, over time, over the different sessions. And if I choose the modal parameter history window here, you can now see some dots here. What you're seeing here is actually a diagram where we have the natural frequency or the frequency up here on this axis here, and here we have the session. We have one session now, so that means we have one list or one vertical line here of results. This is the frequencies of the modes that has been extracted from this particular session here, from the master session. And what we need to do now is we need to upload a little bit more data, some more reference measurements, so that we can actually figure out which of all these different modes here are repeating themselves over the different reference measurements, and then in some way link those together and use them for tracking these modes over or in the coming sessions. So to do this, we will have to upload the remaining 7 sessions. And we do that by going here. We can now multi-select here from 2 to 8, like this. And then open them. Here we allow to make changes to the order, but everything is okay. And we will now start the upload of each of them and the processing. And you can see now the list here of analysis session grows here from 1 to now 8. And we are now processing the second one here. It takes a little while. And then after that, it goes to the next one. So this will take a little time, as you can see. So in the meantime, let's switch to the presentation and talk a bit about operation mode analysis. What we choose to do is, when we do mode analysis for health monitoring, we like to see actually if the mode parameters, they are steady, the same over time. If something happens, like the frequency drops down, it's a sign that something is happening to our structure that we do not like. Some kind of changes are happening, and of course we need to, we like to know when it happens and be able to then act on it, on this. So the idea is, of course, to do mode analysis of all the different sessions, that all the data that is coming in, and then try to track and see, are we having the same frequencies, the same damping, and the same mode shapes, or are things starting to change in some way? This is what we are working on in the background now in ARTeMIS, and here, what we like to do is, of course, to consider how we actually do it with the methods that we selected. We selected the stochastic subspace identification method. And this one here actually relies on that we estimate a range of so-called state space models. And from these, we extract then the modes. And the modes that are, this, you could say, repeating themselves in different state space models, they are grabbed, taken out, averaged, so that we get some nice global mode estimates from these state-space models. So the way this works, stochastic subspace identification framework, we call it SSI also, just to make it a little bit easier for ourselves. It all works from that we have to estimate a so-called state-space model. And a state-space model looks like this in discrete time. What we have here is we have the raw measurements of the response. In our case, this response vector here is have 10 elements for each time step because we have 10 channels. So you should imagine we have a series of these vectors available, one for each time step. Besides this, this state space system here consists of two important matrices. There is the state matrix here that consists of all the eigenvalues and eigenvectors that describe the dynamic behavior. And then there is another matrix here called the output matrix that in some way links the internal states to the observed output. These two matrices are really important because once we have those estimated from the measurements, we can do an eigenvalue decomposition that looks like this. So we decompose the state matrix here into its eigenvalues that will be a diagonal matrix here. And it's multiplied on both sides with the eigenvectors that are stored in this V matrix here. So from the eigenvalues here, we can then extract the natural frequencies and the damping ratios of the modes. And from the eigenvectors here, if you multiply that from the left with the output matrix here, then we get the mode shapes. So it's quite easy, you could say, once we have A and C estimated, to extract the modes. So the art of SSI is, how can we actually estimate these A and C matrices? The first thing we have to do is we have to make a little magic on this state space model here. We have to develop a so-called predictor or estimator based on it, and this is some Kalman filter theory that has to be applied, and we are then ending up having a Kalman filter running in steady state. And this looks like this. This is the kind of estimator that we need, and we will be estimating, you could say, A and C matrices from. But what is important here is that it's still the same response that we have here, that we get from our measurement system, and it's still the same two matrices A and C here. The rest has changed a little bit, but it's not important for this, this part here. This is the only thing that is important, that is simply that we have these three things here are still the same. So the question is, how can we now estimate these A and C matrices based on this estimator here? The way it works is basically that we stack our raw measurements into a matrix, actually two matrices, but two matrices that looks more or less the same. We call these matrices a Hankel matrix. So what we do is we take the vector at some time step of data, put it here, take the next vector at the next time step and put it here, and stack them on top of each other like this. And then we repeat all of this in the second column here, where we are just shifting things one time. So you should imagine each of the columns here are just shifted versions of the previous column. And we do it for one matrix here, one Hankel matrix here, and then we make another one here, where the only difference actually is that we start another place. We don't start the same place in the two matrices here. And based on these two here, we are able now to do something we call an orthogonal projection, which means that we take one of them and project orthogonal to the other one. And it's a terrible thing, as you can see down here. It's relying on that we have to multiply this one together with itself and invert it and multiply on both sides. And then we take this one and multiply with here. And this is, of course, very time consuming and very memory consuming and so on. But never mind that. The reason why we do this is that we like to get rid of noise. So what we end up getting rid of is all the things that are not, you could say, that are not correlated between these two matrices. So every uncorrelated terms, things that are not, you could say, the same here and here, statistically, is being removed by doing this operation down here. And we end up having a, you could say, a cleaned up version of our data. This is now stored in this big matrix here we call the common SSI matrix. This matrix here has some nice properties, actually. It turns out that it can actually be described in terms of two other matrices. So that it can be described in terms of this product here, where you have this matrix here we call the observability matrix, and then another matrix. What is important here is that we would like to extract this left matrix here from the known matrix here, because if we can get that one out, we have it actually located here. We can see it's directly related in its structure to the system matrices of the state space system. So that means once we have this one here, we can extract the C matrix from the top part, and then from some mathematical voodoo, we can actually also extract the state matrix from the remaining parts of it. There are different ways to do that. We are having something we call a crystal clear SSI solver that does it for us and produces very nice clean stabilization. But we get all that from this observability matrix. So the only thing we have to do here is to consider how can we actually get this left part here from this one. And here we need to make use of something we call singular value decomposition. This is a tool that can be used for many, many things in matrix algebra. We use it here to, you would say, cut over a matrix in two, a left and a right part. So we apply the singular value decomposition to this matrix of known process data. And we get some singular vectors that we can organize in two sets, one and two. We get some singular values that corresponds to it. This is a diagonal matrix we get here. And we get some other singular vectors over here that we don't really interest ourselves for. Because it turns out, if we want to have the left part of this H matrix extracted, which is our observability matrix, we simply choose a subspace of all of the full space here. So we choose a subspace. This is the light green color here. So we choose all these singular values here and the corresponding singular vectors here. So we take these singular vectors here and we multiply with the square root of the chosen singular values here. And then we will end up having the left part of this matrix here, which is the observability matrix. And once we have that one, we just pick out A and C and we are then done. We have modes after an eigenvalue decomposition. So the only thing that we actually have to do in the stochastic subspace, that is to consider how many of these singular values we would like to use. This is what we call the subspace identification. We don't really know it up front. So we can start picking out one. And if we pick out one, we get one singular vector here. That means that this one here will just be a single column matrix, which means that the state dimension here of this one here will be one. There will be one eigenvalue available then. If we take out two of these singular values here, we will get two columns in this one here, and therefore we can extract two eigenvalues. And this way, by extending how many of these singular values that we want to include, we get bigger and bigger state space dimension and more eigenvalues estimated. And in this way, we can then estimate hopefully all the modes we have in our system. So it's a kind of an iterative process. We start from one and we go all the way up to the maximum number we can produce. And then hopefully we get a kind of a stabilization diagram that allows us to extract the modes that are repeating themselves from one dimension to another. This is basically what we have here in the stochastic subspace identification, what we are doing and what takes some time to do. There are other things also, of course, available like uncertainty estimation, but let's not spend time on that now. You can see here now, when I switch back to the software, now we have processed these 8 reference measurements here. We have this diagram here. Each of these bars that are now showing up here in vertically here, this is an analysis session. This is data that has been uploaded and processed. And you can see there is a shift of some of the frequencies, but you can also see that the first frequency here of the first mode is quite stable, as you can see. And it also looks very stable, the second one here. But up here, it gets a little bit more messy. We cannot really hear assess which of these belongs together and so on. So we like to have the software help us to track which of all these modes are actually the same. The first thing we have to do to make that work is that we have to select some of these, all these 8 reference measurements here. We have to select at least a part of them and then try to look for similar looking modes in this subset of sessions. The ones we can see that are in common, that has more or less not deviating too much in frequency, not deviating too much in damping and mode shape, we will take those out and we will then make an average of them. So you can imagine we could pick out the first 6 ones of the first mode here, these 6 estimates here, and then make an average frequency of those 6 estimates and do the same for the damping and the mode shape. We then get what we call a reference mode. That would be a kind of an average mode in the reference state that we will use for tracking through all the different sessions and see if we can get something similar there. So we need this kind of estimate, the initial estimate, to actually kickstart the tracking of modes. So to make this work, I simply go to this little tool here and I select which of all these 8 reference session I have here that I would like to use for setting up these reference modes. I can choose to do the first 6 of them, for example. Then I click start. And now you can see the diagram changes. Now we have something linked together here. This one here is now linked to this one here and so on. And all of the modes that are here, if I point at it here, you can also see it being highlighted in the tree, the called data organizer. All of these are looking the same. And they're all looking like this reference mode that has been calculated based on the first 6 of them. And the same for these that are linked together here, and up here also, and so on. So you can see we have four modes that we can track through all these eight measurements here. And this is, you could say, the startup for mode analysis, automatic mode analysis. After this, we can actually now start uploading data automatically and then just keep monitoring how this actually develops this diagram here. And we do that by going here to this little tool here. This is automatic file upload. Here we can configure where we would like to look for data. So we have to tell in this folder here on this network drive here or something, this is where I like to go and look for data. I just have to find the spots that I like to do that for. I have a little folder here that is currently empty called monitor. This one here I will select. I will look for some file type. In this case, it's a binary file, but you can see there is a lot of different file formats available that you can look for. All the ones that we actually support are here. But we choose to do the binary file format here. Then down here, there is something about what to do. Once we have uploaded the data, we need to do something about this with this data file, because if it keep on lying in the same folder, we will keep on uploading it. So you have to tell what kind of post-processing action you want to do on that file. And here we choose to move it to somewhere else. So I have to choose the folder that I like to move it to. And I go into that monitor folder again, and then I have this imported folder here that is also an empty folder, and I select that one. So every time I now have some data that I read into ARTeMIS and create an analysis session for, when I'm done with that, I put it in that imported folder. So it's away. I can also choose to delete it or something else. That's it. Then we click finish here, and we can now start looking for the file. So I put this on, I turn it on, the automatic file upload, and now every second it was set up to look for new data every second in this folder here. This can be changed, of course, to every hour or something. But right now we are looking very, very quickly every second to see if there's something happening in that folder. What I have to do now is I have to simulate that I'm an acquisition system. I will grab some data here now, these damage cases here. I can copy those. And then I'll simply dump them into this imported folder here now. In this way, emulating that I'm an acquisition system that is now dumping a new file that has been recorded from a structure in this folder here. So I simply press paste here. Then the software should start. You can see now it starts uploading the data. You can actually see it here behind that we now have this first session defined. It is called the same, as you can see, as the file name that was used. And it's now doing the mole analysis. And of course, this is going to take some time. So let's not waste that time. Let's go back to the presentation here. And then carry on with the next topic that we are going to look at afterwards. This topic is the damage detection, which we have developed as an alternative or as a complement to the mode analysis. And you could say the motivation for doing it was that we would like to upload data and get a quickly yes or no if something has changed or not. This is, of course, a lot to ask for, but this is what we try to aim for doing in this tool here. So you say the benefits of this is that we don't have to look at mole parameters anymore. We are estimating actually a state space system now, and we are studying then if this state space system is changing or not. So we are not looking at the specific modes or anything, but we are looking at the whole thing that it has been estimated. So it's a robust and very quickly way of assessing a lot of information. And what we get out of it is simply one number, a damage indicator that is above or below a certain threshold. This is what we aim to do here. let's go back to some theory here, because this, the theory that this has been developed from is very much related to the stochastic subspace identification framework that we saw before. It is basically the same. Before, we saw something we call a data-driven SSI. Here we are using what we call covariance-driven SSI framework. So instead of using the raw measurements, we have to process the raw measurements and obtain something we call covariance functions or covariance matrices at different time lags, stuff these into a Hankel matrix, and then based on those, extract the dynamics of the system. So you should imagine that we upload measurements into a session. These measurements are again this Y vector here we have here. From these measurements here, we can now calculate the covariance function, covariance matrix at a certain time lag I between the measurements. And we have to calculate a whole range of different covariance matrix here with different time lags. After having done that, we stuff this into this matrix here. Again, a Hankel matrix. So now you can see we start with time lag one here, and then two and three and four and so on down here. And then the next column here is simply the shifted version one more time, but now from of covariance matrices. So then we start from the second time lag in this case here. And in this way, we can now build up this Hankel matrix here of covariance information. What is really nice is that this matrix here is again directly related to the dynamics of the system, of the state space system. Again, it consists of a product of the observability matrix here on the left side, and then in this case, the controllability matrix over here. So you can see it's very much familiar with what we saw just before. The left part here is still our dynamic description of the data. And this is the one that we would like to focus on here. So we focus on the left part, you could say, of our Hankel matrix. So based on this, you would say, fact that we can now estimate the dynamics of the system in this observability matrix. Let's do that for a series of measurements. So we will collect a whole bunch of measurement files in a reference state. And then each time we do that, we will then produce a Hankel matrix of these covariances. And we will then take that Hankel matrix and we will sum it together with all the previous ones and do an average of all of them. And we end up then with a Hankel matrix that is an average of all these reference measurements. In this way, we get all the description of the system, the variations that this system has over that time where we have collected these reference measurements. And this is a way we can build in variations of the dynamics. And then we extract the observability matrix from that averaged Hankel matrix. And the idea is then that we come later on, maybe 1 year later, we do a measurement on the structure. We form then the Hankel matrix based on the measurements, and we extract this this observability matrix now of the system that might potentially be damaged. And the way we will then do things, in principle at least, is that we will try to see what happens if I do if I take the observability matrix of my reference state and subtract from the newly identified observability matrix of my potential damage state. If I subtract these two here, and the difference between these two here turns out to be a non-zero matrix, then it means that the dynamics has changed. If we can subtract these two from one another and we basically get zero matrix here, we are on the safe side. There is no change in the dynamics between the two times that we have been recording these measurements. So this is, you could say, in principle, what we have to do. To make it a little bit easier to work with, we vectorize it that's what I put here back in front. It simply means that instead of having a matrix, I simply take the different columns and stack them on top of each other. So I have one long vector of differences to work with. We also call this a residual vector. We have two challenges now. First of all, we have to be able to calculate this difference between reference and damage state, potential damage state, in an effective manner. This leads us to something you can see over here that I come back to what is. Once we have done that, we need to look at, you could say, these residuals we get out here. We have to study in a statistical manner. How close are we to zero, or how far away are we? Are we too far away so that we can say that statistically we have a change here, or are we so close to the original reference observability matrix that everything is okay? We use some residual testing to make that choice for us. So there are these two things we have to go through now. The first thing is, of course, we have to have this effective way of calculating this say subtraction of the two observability matrices. The way we do it is we start out from the reference Hankel matrix, the one that has been averaged over a lot of measurements in the reference state. What we will do is we will take that reference Hankel matrix and then again decompose it using the singular value decomposition here. We saw that already before in the SSI, that we can do this. And to obtain the observability matrix, we had to take the singular vectors here, the first ones here, and then multiply them with the square root of these singular values up here. Now, in the what we do now is actually we take the other singular vectors here. This is the so-called left null space. If I take these out and I multiply these from the left to this matrix I got them from, I get a zero matrix. So it's a way to assess if I have a new matrix that has the same properties as the one I got this null space from. I can simply take my left null space and then multiply from the left the new matrix here. If I get a null matrix out, everything is good. It's the same observability, the same left part of this new matrix we have. And that means that the observability matrix in the damage, potential damage state looks like the one in the reference state. So this is an effective way of doing that simply by calculating this left null space here. This is also called the left kernel. And we use that in order to rapidly make this subtraction of the two states. Once we have that done, we get from this, we get then a potential null matrix if everything is good. Again, we vectorize this to get a residual vector. And the outcomes here, then this vector here, this is just a scale with the square root of the number of elements we have in it, or the number of data points, samples of the measurements. So we get here a residual vector out here. This one here, we can actually calculate, say, in the reference state from the different reference measurements we have uploaded. And if we do that and we chop it up in segments, we can actually estimate the covariance matrix from these estimates here of the residuals. So by some mathematics, we will get this covariance function, covariance matrix here of the residuals inside the reference state. We will get this one calculated. And we use that one now to, when we do the statistical assessment of whether we are having, you could say, an observability matrix that looks like the one we have in the reference state. We simply take the residual vector here that we have obtained, multiply on both sides of this in the inverted covariance function here, or covariance matrix of the residuals. This gives us the chi-square value. This will be a value close to zero if the new data we have here from a new measurement looks like the one we have in the reference state. If this starts deviating because the dynamics are changing, then this chi-square value here will dramatically increase in size. We can try to see how that looks here. Normally, we will use a diagram like you see down here. We will try to show you the chi-square values as bars here. So what you have up here, this axis here, is just the chi-square value. And then the bars here will then show you the size of them. Based on these values here in the reference state, we can then calculate some thresholds based on some different, you could say, quantiles of the underlying distribution. So normally we will have a 95% threshold, 95% significance level, and one for 99%. This is our default two thresholds we have. And if we start exceeding the 95, we say now we are critical close to a change. If we exceed 99, then we say, okay, now we really have changed. Something has really changed in the dynamics. You can also see it here. Once we have now damage here, this is a simulation, so there is a 15% increase of a damage here. At this point here, all these bars here, they passes through these two thresholds here, which indicates to us that now we actually have damage here, because we are above the thresholds. And as the damage grows, we get more and more or higher bars here, because the distance between the two, you could say, distributions, the one that describes the chi-square distribution in the healthy state, now the ones we have for the damage state is way off. There is a large distance between them. You can actually also see that if you illustrate it in another way, where we here have a histogram of all the different test values we have for the healthy state. They form a chi-square distribution that looks like the blue one here. Once we start doing damage, this one will move out. It will still be, you say, a distribution, the chi-square distribution, but it will be moved out in this axis here, it will move out here. And the more damage we get, the longer the distance will be. These thresholds that you saw here before, they are actually also now located here. This will be the 95% threshold here. So that means that at this point here, there is only 5% left of this distribution here, or this histogram here. 5% of, you could say, the values, the bars, are over here on this side here. In this case here, with the red one here, there is only 1% left. So the longer or the higher threshold we get here, the longer we get out this way here, the further away from the center of this distribution we get. It also shows us that if we have a threshold of 99% here, there will still be some, you could say, measurements in the healthy state, in the undamaged state, that might pass through this threshold here. Not guarantee that you will not get false alarms, but since you have so few of them, because you are so close to you would say 100% when you have 99, you only have very few of these false alarms happening. So that means that our recommendation would be that you repeat the test, do another measurement on the structure, and then see if you're still above the threshold. Because if it was in the healthy state, you would probably most likely go back and then stay below the threshold again. And it would just be a statistical outlier, you can say, that you had. But so repeat the test one or two times or more, just to see if you stay up there in the high level. Then you have to start concluding that something has changed. So this is the way that we do it in the software. Let's go back here and then try it. But first, let's just have a brief look here. You can actually see here the completed mode analysis now of all the sessions. The two first modes here, they are more or less unchanged. Whereas at this point here, the first damage file that we upload, suddenly this third bit uncertain mode here, but the third mode, it can't be tracked anymore. It's impossible. And we can see number four is an uncertain mode, but it can still be tracked. But at least the third mode shows us here that something has happened here. There is something going on here from the first damage measurement here that we need to have a look at. So let's now try to select or move to the damage detection to see how that actually performs on the same data here. We go here to, we have two different methods available. We take the one we call the classic method. And what I have to do now is I have to set it up. I have to tell how many of all these reference measurements I have over here I would like to include in this angle matrix that I want to create, this average angle matrix that I like to create in the beginning. So I have to tell how many of all the sessions I have that are in the reference state I would like to use for that. I could of course choose all of them, but it's nice to keep a few of them outside and leave, let's say, two of these not used for creating this reference state model, as we call it. It's better to leave some out and then use those for validation, because they are taken, these two measurements are taken in the reference state, undamaged state. So that means if we test it up against this reference state model, they should stay below the thresholds. If they don't do that, it's probably because our model that we have created is not good enough. So it is, it's a way to validate what we are doing. So what we have to do is we have to go step by step through the things. The first we do is we select to use the first six measurements in this case here. So I will use the six first measurements to create my reference state model. This model here consists of this left kernel. This we use for subtracting things together. And it also consists of the covariance matrix of the residuals. So these are the two major things that are being calculated along with the thresholds that are being used. This is what we need this range of reference measurements for. So we simply press start here. And now the software will read these six measurements here, create this left kernel, the null space we use for the subtraction. Once we have that and we have the covariance matrix available, we will go back and then read each of the six measurements, construct the Hankel matrix of each of those, and calculate the chi-square value. So in this way, we actually now recalculate the chi-square value of each of these six measurements here that was used to produce actually the full reference state model here. But based on this, we can now estimate the thresholds here. So they are actually based on the values that we have obtained from these six measurements here. That's why we need multiple measurements. Otherwise, we cannot make a threshold. We cannot make a statistical, say, based value. That's not possible. So we need multiple measurements to do that. But you can see now we have this is the 95% threshold, and we have then the 99% up here like this. This can be changed, of course, over here if you want to have some other measures instead of these two. The next thing we will do is we will take the remaining part of our reference state measurements. We had two left. We will use those to test what we have actually done here. We should still be in the green zone here because they are obtained in the reference state, but they are not used to construct the statistics that are being used. So it's independent measurements, independent of what we have now. And that's why it's good for validation. And we do that simply by selecting here again, the second option here, validate reference. And now you can see it suggests the next two measurements here for the validation. And we use those two, we click start. And you can see that we are now outside the gray range here, that is our reference range, reference state calculation range, you could say. Now we are actually having two new measurements tested here, and you can see we are still in the green zone. We are below the two thresholds, which indicates to us that this is actually very good. It's a good reference state model we have built here that can actually be used to test this data here. So now it's just a matter of if we didn't have started already the automatic upload, this would be a good time to do it, because from now on we can do automatic damage detection with this tool here. We have already the data in loaded here, so what I have to do is I simply have to go to the last step here and then tell that I would like whatever is already read into ARTeMIS to be processed. And I do that by hitting this button here, and you can now see how we get passage of the red, both the yellow and the red threshold, and the bars turn red in this case here, indicating that we are now exceeding the 99% significance level, and which means that we most likely have a change of the dynamics of this this structure here in these measurements. What we can do just to finish this, we can actually overlay the things in the same diagram. I can do something like this. So here you can actually see the measurements. It's the same axis we have of sessions. And we can see when we have the first red passage here, indicating that there is a damage, this corresponds to that the mole analysis can actually no longer track the third mode. So there is, of course, a consistency between the two diagrams, but you can see in some way it's much easier to get a single number out that is either red or green, yes or no, and then use that as a kind of a guideline for if I have to go back and do a more detailed mole analysis to figure out what is actually wrong with my structure. This is, you could say, what I would like to show in the data here, there's the software. Just to wrap this up, I have a little example here. That is a bridge that was tested, actually it was demolished some years ago in Austria. And before there was, a consortium of different companies and institutions were allowed to do some damaging and test the different damage detection algorithms. And we have been allowed to use the data and show what we can do with ARTeMIS. And we have some modes here that just shows we did a mode analysis on some reference state measurements that was available. And there are some nice modes, as you can see here. What is more interesting is this picture here. This is the bridge here. While it was being demolished, they did some cutting of this column here and lowering of it. They also removed or cut some rebars and some stuff on other parts of it. And while they were doing all of this, they recorded continuously the response of, I cannot remember, 15 channels or something, I think it is in this case here. We have measurements, we have 689 measurement files, sessions we would call them, in this data here. We have used 100 for establishing the reference state model. This is the gray zone we have here. We have then the remaining safe zone or reference measurements here before they start doing the damaging. These are the ones that you see here. They are still nice green in this case here below the threshold. Then they start, you can see this A here indicates the time of the first damage that you have here, where they cut through the column for the first time. You can then see how this indicator is raising up dramatically. This is actually a logarithmic scale. So a lot of things happen here when you have an increase of the values here. So it's very, very easy to see in this case here that something is happening to this structure here. A significant change from this level here to up to the next level we have here. So this is some of the things that we can use damage detection for to help us identifying when something is happening. Just to conclude a little bit, ARTeMIS is a quite open piece of software. It allows you to actually upload measurement files from a lot of different formats. So I think we have around 20 file formats right now. If we don't have it and you have a specific need, we are very flexible if we can just get some specifications so we can make an upload facility. And in this way, this is how we get our list of our file formats growing all the time. It's designed so that you can automatically or manually upload files, measurement files. I did both here today. And the same with the export of results. I didn't actually show that, but you can actually automatically or manually, for that sake, export modes out every time you get something analyzed. On the operational mode analysis side, we actually have up to 8 different techniques or algorithms available that you can run in parallel. For this type of analysis here that runs automatically, we prefer to use the stochastic subspace identification algorithms, and we have 4 of those in the software. I've been using the most advanced method we have. This one is estimating both, you could say, mean values of the modes, but also uncertainty information. You get also the variance or standard deviations of the different parameters as well. And we use that, of course, to get more robust estimate of the modes that we extract. Then on the damage detection part here, we have 2 different methods available. I showed you one of them, but you could actually use 2 in parallel, and then you can join the results together using a control chart option that we have. And in this way, you can reduce whatever uncertainty you might have in each of these estimators. And in this way, get more robust results to assess damage from. And they are all relying on the same statistical testing of these residuals that I have been talking about. So I hope you had something out of this little webinar here. We have, of course, more things lying around of information. We have a YouTube channel. It's not a really beautiful link I have to show you here, but if you go to YouTube and you search for ARTeMIS Modal, I'm sure you'll find this this particular location here very easily. And otherwise, we have on our website, we have a lot of literature on both operational mode analysis, but also on the damage detection and some other topics, of course. So there, of course, you can also, if you want to try the software, you can actually download the software also and get a trial license there. Finally, the next webinar that I'll be giving will concern classical or experimental mode analysis. And I will be giving the first of these 2. I have a morning session here on June 3 with this, and then the next day there will be one in the afternoon. So I hope to see some of you there again, and I thank you very much for listening in this afternoon here. Thank you very much, and bye for now.